I'm Dr. Thomas McKenna. I'm a program officer at the Office of Naval Research. So there's substantial losses incurred when you have a major fire, when you can't suppress it at an early stage. SAFER is the shipboard autonomous firefighting robot. And this is a program that's been going on for about 5 years, basically to develop a humanoid capable of fire suppression.
My name is John Farley. I work at the Naval Research Laboratory, and I'm the director of the Shadwell, which is the Navy's fire test ship. If we have a shipboard fire, we have to be able to quickly get it under control and then regain the ship's ability to maintain its fighting mission. You know, we have not only the ship, but we have ordnance on board, and we have a lot of flammable systems on board. Sometimes it's hard to keep the sailors up to the latest as far as training is concerned. Or sometimes they could create an environment and make it worse. Now the robot could be trained and constantly updated to make sure that the conditions are not as bad as what a human could make it.
Well, our objectives for the demo on the Shadwell were to show that the robot could walk over what was a very uneven floor, that it could orient itself to the fire, that it could autonomously handle the hose, operate the hose, aim the hose, and suppress the fire, which it succeeded in.
I'm Brian Latimer. I'm an associate professor at Virginia Tech in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. I think robots are well suited to be sent into those environments, and bipedal humanoid robots are particularly good for those applications because even in the tight, confined conditions that you might have inside of structures, these types of robots can be designed to maneuver in those conditions. SAFER is an electromechanical robot, so it's driven by batteries and all the motors are electrical. So we put a rain gear type suit on the robot just to protect it from those types of basic steam, particulate, and water drop hazards. So we have visible cameras on board the robot. We have something called a LIDAR, which is a rotating laser that gives the location of the points in the field of the view of the robot. And then lastly, we have stereoscopic thermal imaging cameras that the robot uses to detect and locate the position of a fire so they can suppress it.
We combine the notion of smart sensors in the spaces, microflyers that can fly even in smoke, go through those extremely narrow doors that it could locate fires and operate in those hallways even in dense fire smoke. And it succeeded all those tasks.
So today was the first time we came on board an actual Navy ship. We were able to do a lot of things today that we hadn't done previously, and we have a lot of hope for new advancements in the future.
We have some fundamental issues in robotic mobility that we still have to address, as well as working out the human system integration issues. And we'll continue to advance the capability with better and better demonstrations. At the current time, the robot is teleoperated, so you have operators standing off with a computer console. Where we intend to go is to have a combination of natural language and gesture control.
I think the robot has gone through amazing transition within 4 years, and I think it's a worthy investment for a long-term project. But it's going to take a lot of time, a lot of dedication.
And we're working towards human-robot teams, what we call the hybrid force. Humans and robots working together.
Over the past decade, I've watched American troops operate on the front lines of war in Iraq and Afghanistan, both as a U.S. Marine and later as a journalist. During that time, two things have struck me. First, Americans have developed a low tolerance for seeing their soldiers return home in coffins. And second, soldiers are surrounded by an overwhelming amount of new technology. It's now part of their everyday lives. These two trends are shifting the way the U.S. fights its wars. The Pentagon is currently building an army of what it calls unmanned systems. It's their fastest growing arm of development. And there's a momentum to create machines with more autonomous capabilities, robots which can take certain decisions themselves. But what will this new era of warfare look like? And do the legal and political structures exist to deal with it?
These are big, big meta changes that are happening in war that we've got to wrap our heads around.
So I see this as a very major threat to respect for human rights.
What is war going to look like when it's robot versus robot? Who wins that war? And how can you even tell?
This is the largest gathering of robotics companies in the world. It's organized by AUVSI, the Association of Unmanned Vehicle Systems International.
So these are successfully used in operations at the reactors.
Hundreds of private corporations and university researchers are here to show off their latest cutting-edge inventions.
And so there's things that we can actually pick up with the gripper, use them to defuse a bomb, and then put them back.
They're all either selling their products or soliciting funds for their projects. And most of them are targeting a single customer with deep pockets, the U.S. military.
This is an annual conference for the robotics industry in Washington, D.C. And years ago, this was a pretty small gathering. This year, there'll be over 7,000 attendees. It's an enormous business here now. It covers everything. You'd be surprised what you could find. Everything from unmanned boat ships, submarines, to armed drone helicopters. And just the air portion of the robotics or unmanned industries this year will be worth $7 billion.
In 2009, the U.S. Defense Department earmarked $18 billion over 5 years for the development of unmanned systems. This boom in military robotics comes off the back of the so-called global war on terror. The wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, along with lethal action in Pakistan and Libya, have created a political and strategic space for unmanned robotic systems.
It's not a situation where you're in these big, you know, formation operations or fights. You're dealing with very explosive, very spontaneous events. So you need something that's watching all the time and something that's very adaptable to be able to move in from one location to another very, very quickly.
The U.S. Air Force is presently training more unmanned systems operators than it's training manned fighter plane and manned bomber plane pilots put together. But that actually makes perfect sense because they're actually buying more unmanned systems than they're buying manned fighter planes or manned bomber planes.
The number of drones in use by the U.S. military has surged from a handful in 2001 to over 7,000 today. And the number of ground robots has shot from zero to 12,000. When you start to take a look, the amount of robot research funded by the U.S. military is astonishing. Faultlines put in more than 100 requests and follow-ups to the Pentagon, military contractors, private robotics companies, and university research labs. But gaining access to see how these tax dollars are put into use isn't easy. When we could actually get a response, it was almost always a firm no. After several months of chasing, only a handful agreed to allow us to film. Tardec was one of them. It sits on a base just outside Detroit, Michigan.
If you just want to try it out, drive.
Seriously? That's it.
An Army research facility from World War II. It used to build tanks.
Wow, look at that.
Now much of their work is dedicated to robotic technology.
What we're looking at here at Tardec is unstructured environments. So robots that can move out of the area of very strict programming. So one of the ways of doing that is through teleoperation. So we have, it's not the classic robot. It's somebody actually controlling something. It's not a remote controlled car because they're doing it through a TV set.
All the robots here are collaborations between TARDEC and private companies or university labs, or both. Companies like iRobot in Bedford, Massachusetts. This is the home of the PACBOT, one of the first ground-based robots the U.S. military adopted after 9/11. Thousands are being used in Iraq and Afghanistan to defuse improvised explosive devices, or IEDs.
The old way of doing business was to ask an individual, our sons, our daughters, our brothers, our sisters, to mount up one of those heavy, cumbersome, hot bomb suits and literally to waddle out to go face to face with an IED. Today, we do that at distance and we do it virtually via a robot. Much, much better way to do business.
So the interesting thing about this one is light. It weighs about 5 pounds or so. And here's what the military wanted. A robot that you could throw, say over a wall or something, and then look, it rights itself. And now you can see over that wall with the cameras on that robot.
With video game-like controllers, soldiers can guide recon robots like this one to see over walls or defuse bombs. These ground-based robots add a buffer between the soldiers that use them and a potential threat, whether it's a bomb or a human enemy. But technology designed to save lives can be easily modified to kill.
The step between putting a laser beam on someone's forehead, it's not a technologic leap to then putting a bullet in their forehead. It's actually a legal political question.
We feel strongly and ethically that there has to be a man in the loop. If you look at the history of any military technology, it typically starts in reconnaissance, then becomes frustrated that you see bad happenings but can't deal with them, and it evolves to strike.
Really, the technology will happen. It's how we're going to deal with that technology.
While the idea of arming ground robots still seems taboo, in the air, it's a line that has long been crossed. At a Utah Army testing facility, the military has invited members of the media to a display of its unmanned aerial systems.
We're going to showcase that entire package for you here today in a way that I think is going to really resonate with you once you see what's inside and behind the curtain.
It's the largest drone demonstration the U.S. Defense Department has ever allowed to be filmed. As the drones fly overhead, journalists watch the mock operation from inside a hangar. From 7,000 meters in the air, the Gray Eagle hunts its target.
8-9, Overlord Main, maintain eyes on that truck.
It's estimated that the Pentagon will invest nearly $37 billion toward drone development through 2020.
Shadow 5-5, Roger.
Advancing unmanned systems more than piloted aircraft.
Oh, I think it's fundamentally changed warfare. I think it's fundamentally changed the way we operate. I think eventually it's going to fundamentally change the way we live in the United States.
And now we have a technology that allows you to carry out acts of force without having to think about some of the consequences, the political consequences of sending sons or daughters into harm's way. So in my mind, the barriers to war in our society, they were already being lowered. Now we have a technology that literally takes those barriers to the ground.
All of which make it such an attractive tool for the U.S. But drones are some of the most controversial weapons in the American arsenal, particularly in their use for targeted killings, a phrase first termed under the Bush administration's so-called war on terror, to use lethal force against specific individuals. It means killing people, often outside official war zones. The program has been ramped up under the Obama administration.
It's in places where there would be very serious geopolitical ramifications and the ramifications of American lives being placed on the ground in those dangerous situations, the drone appears like a silver bullet.
Pakistan has borne the brunt of the silver bullet. And it's all secret. The CIA, not the military, runs the Pakistani drone program. The CIA is not required to offer any information about its operations, how it selects its targets, who's in charge, and how many people are killed. And the Obama administration will not officially discuss the CIA drone program, not even to confirm or deny its existence.
If they can't even say the word, where's the accountability? How could we even know how well this program is working, even if you want to put aside the questions about whether we should be using drones as instruments of war? There's just so little transparency and so much opacity when it comes to this program, when it belongs to the CIA, that some people now think if it belonged to the military, you could at least get more insight into how it works and then debate about whether it should be run this way.
Reportedly, civilians and private contractors control the CIA drones, pushing a button from their offices thousands of miles away in Langley, Virginia. At the time this film was made, there have been 308 drone strikes reported in Pakistan since 2004. 256 of those under President Obama. That figure could be far higher. Over 200 strikes hit the region of Waziristan alone. Roughly one attack every 4 days. Conservative estimates put the total number of deaths around 2,900. Of those, over 750 were civilians, including 175 children. And at least 1,100 people have been injured. The CIA and the Obama administration have extended these strikes to Yemen and Somalia. And according to recent U.S. diplomatic cables released by WikiLeaks, the United States is building secret drone bases in places like Ethiopia and the Seychelles, an indication that Washington wants to increase surveillance and strikes in the region. At least a dozen strikes have been carried out in Yemen, one of which in late September killed Anwar al-Awlaki, an American-born imam with alleged ties to al-Qaeda. The willingness to target and kill a U.S. citizen provides just one example of how this secret war often operates beyond recognized legal boundaries.
If a intelligence operation carries out an airstrike that goes awry, that accidentally kills civilians, that violates the rules of engagement, there's not a court-martial process set up for that.
There is, in my view, at the end of the day, no accountability for what is going on now.
Philip Alston spent 6 years studying the legality of the U.S. drone program for the United Nations Human Rights Council.
The congressional committees have, as far as anyone knows, never exercised oversight in any specific way in relation to these killings.
He says that the American government's justification for the strikes, self-defense in response to 9/11, even now, 10 years later, is a manipulation of the international laws governing conflict.
Now, in terms of international law, that represents a fundamental breakdown in what are called the rules on the use of force. It would enable the United States to use force against any target, any country, any time.
Following 9/11, Congress passed a resolution called the Authorization for Use of Military Force, or AUMF. It allows the U.S. president to use military force anywhere against people believed to be responsible for 9/11.
And when the Obama administration has been asked, what authorities do you possess to go, you know, into Yemen, to go into Somalia, even, you know, outside Afghanistan, into Pakistan, for the purposes of attacking people that you say are aligned with al-Qaeda, they use the AUMF.
I think the U.S. is certainly risking setting itself up for a significant global backlash against its extension of power extraterritorially. But the bigger problem, of course, is other states saying, well, this is the norm. You do it. Why shouldn't we do it?
The UN Human Rights Council has taken no action to further investigate the legality of the U.S. drone program. While the U.S. continues to expand the program, 45 other nations are working on their own drones, many being sold on the open market. In the rush to churn out robotic military systems, who buys these technologies and how they're used has minimal international oversight. In short, the law is not keeping up with the pace of development.
You know, technology doesn't stop, and that's, I think, one thing that people need to realize is that it's accelerating ever faster, not just in the number that we're using it, but how advanced it is.
The accelerated pace of development is such that it is inevitable that we are creating machines that are going to be able to do things we cannot currently conceive of them doing.
I think if the United States were serious, part of this major program to, if you want to create a word, to robotize its war-making functions, would be to build in various safeguards designed to ensure respect for the laws of war.
There has been a mad dash for advancement with very little consideration for how that advancement will play out against human society. And
Rita J. King is a futurist who studies the potential dangers that technological advances in robotics and artificial intelligence can bring.
Within the United States, you have the military, and then you have, you know, private business, and you have universities. So all these different groups are doing their own research and their own creations at different paces. And eventually, there will be more of a coming together of these different aspects of the programming and the creations, and we will cross a line.
In a university lab at Virginia Tech, Professor Dennis Hong and his students work on a robotic soccer team.
The real thing is, if you want to use these... robots outside the lab in real life doing real work, then without all the skills needed to playing soccer, it won't happen. So we're actually, it's a really good controlled competition where we can develop all the technologies needed for robots to be used in real life.
Virginia Tech's funding comes from a variety of sources. These robots are part of a project sponsored by the National Science Foundation. But they also take on projects financed by the U.S. military.
So as a research lab, the technology we develop, we want the society to be using our technology. Of course, many of our robotics projects, most of them, if not all of them, are to really to help the society.
But here they recognize that a technology's ultimate use is unpredictable.
Time to time, as a group, we sit down and discuss about these kind of problems. Mainly, it's very sensitive, especially for work on military-funded projects and those kind of things. But many times, we don't have any control once it leaves our hands. However, that's true for any technologies, any science besides robotics as well.
It's hard to put a timeline on how fast robots and artificial intelligence will develop. But almost everyone we spoke to seemed to believe that in just a few decades, the robots that will exist in our world will be unrecognizable by today's standards.
I think the probability is virtually one, a certainty, that machines will be as intelligent as people, that we will have intelligent robots, that robots will be ubiquitous. So then the consensus of people in the industry is somewhere around 2025, 2030, you know, and even if you were to say, oh, that's optimistic, so maybe it's 2050. You know, maybe some of us won't be around to see it, perhaps, but it's not that far in the future. It's not 1,000 years. It's not 500 years. It's certainly not never. When people say machines will never be as smart as people, never is a very long time.
The robots that we create could, of course, eventually will become much smarter than we are. And because they're smarter than us, we won't be able to conceive of how smart they are. And we'll have no control over that. And I don't think our brains are really equipped to accept the enormity of what that means, because we do find ourselves intelligent now.
Science fiction stories have always made predictions about conflict between machines and people. The way to avoid that is for humans to always be at least as intelligent as their machines.
While we may not know exactly if or when robots will become as intelligent as humans, at AUVSI, the talk of autonomy, of military robots taking more decisions by themselves, is growing.
You know, work on, you know, the next generation of autonomy, maybe before it's really needed, to show where it can go. General Riggs talked about unfair advantage, and I'm in full agreement with him. We want unfair advantage. We want lots of unfair advantage. Why shouldn't we? And unmanned systems, and especially weaponized unmanned systems, clearly provide a huge advantage.
So how far will robot autonomy go? And will a robot ever be allowed to make the ultimate decision, to take a human life? Officially, the U.S. military claims there will always be a man in the loop, that a human will always make the decision to kill. But there are signs that this may not always be the case. In 2006, the Army funded a major study to find out if lethal autonomous robots could be programmed to act ethically on the battlefield.
There's a long and rich history of war crimes in every war. We try and train our soldiers, and soldiers are instructed in this, but we are human beings. And there is emotions, there's anger, fear, frustration. We don't have to put those in autonomous systems. We can engineer out the emotions that get in the way.
Ron Arkin, a professor at Georgia Tech, worked on this study and argues that robots can be more ethical than human soldiers, even in decisions to kill, by programming in what he calls bounded morality.
You establish a venue, a region, or a task environment, or a mission under which the system is operating, and you engineer that system to make sure that it acts appropriately under those particular circumstances.
Whether it makes that decision what to fire at, when to fire, and who to fire at, that I think is a critical decision that we already sort of ritualize within the military decision process, and we shouldn't relinquish that. There's reasons to deny people their right to life, self-defense, intervening on behalf of another to defend their life. But those are decisions that human agents and moral agents should be making, and not automatic processes.
I will never, ever make the claim that these systems will be perfect. But I do make the claim that, I have the belief that these systems can outperform human beings in the battlefield, ultimately from an ethical perspective.
We do have a moral responsibility to try to prevent this and to not invest our time and energy and resources as scientists, as a society, into building a technology that has that kind of capacity to kill people on its own.
But for now, there are no signs that research like this will stop. Because there's an assumption that underlies not only Arkin's work, but also the billions spent on defense. The assumption that war will always continue.
War is a very cultural thing. It's a kind of a social deliberation instead of a moral deliberation, or a cultural deliberation, if you will. Like, how do we want to fight wars? What is it to be a warrior in this society? And what does this society decide that war is about and is good for?
In the past, battles had formal boundaries and ends, where each side had to bury their own. But as more robots go to war on behalf of humans, what stake does society hold? As killing becomes more automated, does it make war all too easy?
So I think that is a big issue as far as what these technologies are going to do and making war much easier to become involved in, and really detaching, especially in the United States, the American public from its sense of responsibility and moral and social deliberation that should go into deciding when wars occur.
A lot of people say, well, why don't we stop working on this technology? There's a problem, though. You'd have to stop science. It means you'd also have to first stop war and stop capitalism.
And there's such a vast amount of money that goes into thinking about defense problems and solving defense problems that if we turned that time and energy and resources into solving more practical problems, we would actually probably alleviate most of the social and political problems that cause us to have defense and security concerns.
And the fact of the matter is that most of the funding that's going into robot research, of course, is to create a better war machine. And to what end? It demonstrates how far we are from the sort of intelligence we need to build robots that can help us instead of hurt us.
And water drop hazards. So we have visible cameras on board the robot. We have something called a LIDAR, which is a rotating laser that gives the location of the points in the field of the view of the robot. And then lastly, we have stereoscopic thermal imaging cameras that the robot uses to detect and locate the position of a fire so they can suppress it.
We combine the notion of smart sensors in the spaces, microflyers that can fly even in smoke, go through those extremely narrow doors, that it could locate fires and operate in those hallways, even in dense fire smoke. And it succeeded all those tasks.
So today was the first time we came on board an actual Navy ship. We were able to do a lot of things today that we hadn't done previously, and we have a lot of hope for new advancements in the future.
We have some fundamental issues in robotic mobility that we still have to address, as well as working out the human system integration issues. And we'll continue to advance the capability with better and better demonstrations. At the current time, the robot is teleoperated, so you have operators standing off with the computer console. Where we intend to go is to have a combination of natural language and gesture control.
I think the robot has gone through amazing transition within 4 years, and I think it's a worthy investment for a long-term project. But it's going to take a lot of time, a lot of dedication.
And we're working towards human-robot teams, what we call the hybrid force. Humans and robots working together.
Over the past decade, I've watched American troops operate on the front lines of war in Iraq and Afghanistan, both as a U.S. Marine and later as a journalist. During that time, two things have struck me. First, Americans have developed a low tolerance for seeing their soldiers return home in coffins. And second, soldiers are surrounded by an overwhelming amount of new technology. It's now part of their everyday lives. These two trends are shifting the way the U.S. fights its wars. The Pentagon is currently building an army of what it calls unmanned systems. It's their fastest growing arm of development. And there's a momentum to create machines with more autonomous capabilities, robots which can take certain decisions themselves. But what will this new era of warfare look like? And do the legal and political structures exist to deal with it?
These are big, big meta changes that are happening in war that we've got to wrap our heads around.
So I see this as a very major threat to respect for human rights.
What is war going to look like when it's robot versus robot? Who wins that war? And how can you even tell?
This is the largest gathering of robotics companies in the world. It's organized by AUVSI, the Association of Unmanned Vehicle Systems International.
So these are successfully used in operations at the reactors.
Hundreds of private corporations and university researchers are here to show off their latest cutting-edge inventions.
And so there's things that we can actually pick up with the gripper, use them to defuse a bomb, and then put them back.
They're all either selling their products or soliciting funds for their projects. And most of them are targeting a single customer with deep pockets, the U.S. military.
This is an annual conference for the robotics industry in Washington, D.C. And years ago, this was a pretty small gathering. This year, there'll be over 7,000 attendees. It's an enormous business here now. It covers everything. You'd be surprised what you could find. Everything from unmanned boat ships, submarines, to armed drone helicopters. And just the air portion of the robotics or unmanned industries this year will be worth $7 billion.
In 2009, the U.S. Defense Department earmarked $18 billion.
I'm Dr. Thomas McKenna. I'm a program officer at the Office of Naval Research. So there's substantial losses incurred when you have a major fire, when you can't suppress it at an early stage. SAFER is the shipboard autonomous firefighting robot. And this is a program that's been going on for about 5 years, basically to develop a humanoid capable of fire suppression.
My name is John Farley. I work at the Naval Research Laboratory, and I'm the director of the Shadwell, which is the Navy's fire test ship. If we have a shipboard fire, we have to be able to quickly get it under control and then regain the ship's ability to maintain its fighting mission. You know, we have not only the ship, but we have ordnance on board, and we have a lot of flammable systems on board. Sometimes it's hard to keep the sailors up to the latest as far as training is concerned. Or sometimes they could create an environment and make it worse. Now the robot could be trained and constantly updated to make sure that the conditions are not as bad as what a human could make it.
Well, our objectives for the demo on the Shadwell were to show that the robot could walk over what was a very uneven floor, that it could orient itself to the fire, that it could autonomously handle the hose, operate the hose, aim the hose, and suppress the fire, which it succeeded in.
I'm Brian Latimer. I'm an associate professor at Virginia Tech in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. I think robots are well suited to be sent into those environments, and bipedal humanoid robots are particularly good for those applications because even in the tight, confined conditions that you might have inside of structures, these types of robots can be designed to maneuver in those conditions. SAFER is an electromechanical robot, so it's driven by batteries and all the motors are electrical. So we put a rain gear type suit on the robot just to protect it from those types of basic steam, particulate.
Dollars over 5 years for the development of unmanned systems. This boom in military robotics comes off the back of the so-called global war on terror. The wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, along with lethal action in Pakistan and Libya, have created a political and strategic space for unmanned robotic systems.
It's not a situation where you're in these big, you know, formation operations or fights. You're dealing with very explosive, very spontaneous events. So you need something that's watching all the time and something that's very adaptable to be able to move in from one location to another very, very quickly.
The U.S. Air Force is presently training more unmanned systems operators than it's training manned fighter plane and manned bomber plane pilots put together. But that actually makes perfect sense because they're actually buying more unmanned systems than they're buying manned fighter planes or manned bomber planes.
The number of drones in use by the U.S. military has surged from a handful in 2001 to over 7,000 today. And the number of ground robots has shot from zero to 12,000. When you start to take a look, the amount of robot research funded by the U.S. military is astonishing. Faultlines put in more than 100 requests and follow-ups to the Pentagon, military contractors, private robotics companies, and university research labs. But gaining access to see how these tax dollars are put into use isn't easy. When we could actually get a response, it was almost always a firm no. After several months of chasing, only a handful agreed to allow us to film. Tardec was one of them. It sits on a base just outside Detroit, Michigan.
If you just want to try it out, drive.
Seriously? That's it.
An Army research facility from World War II. It used to build tanks.
Wow, look at that.
Now much of their work is dedicated to robotic technology.
What we're looking at here at Tardec is unstructured environments. So robots that can move out of the area of... Mm-hmm.